Our first chapter of class 10th CBSE board is chapter number 12, electricity, as we know that electricity is a source of energy and we use electricity in many forms. That is, we use it in transport, in machines, and in homes. Electricity is a flow of electric charge in a conductor. So now, what do you mean by electric charge? Electric charge is an intrinsic or inbuilt property of a matter. Which shows force of repulsion or attraction in a body. So, how can we produce electric charge in a body? There are three kinds of substances. We know that one is conductor, another is insulator, and third one is semiconductor. In insulators, we can produce charge by frictional method, that is by rubbing two substances against each other. So producing this kind of electricity by rubbing is known as frictional electricity. Rubbing two objects thus, there are two kinds of charges will develop on the bodies. As we know that atom is electrically neutral, this is nucleus in which neutron and proton is present, and in the orbit electron revolves around it. So atom is electrically neutral, and when we in the case of insulator, when we rub two objects against each other, then one object will acquire positive charge on it and the other will acquire negative charge, equal negative charge on it. So this is known as positive charge and negative charge bodies. Now these positively charged bodies are known as protons, or positively charged particles are known as protons, and negatively charged particles are known as electrons. Other point is, one proton contains 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19 electron coulomb of positive charge in it. Also, one electron contains 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19 coulomb of charges which are negative. Now, by this we can find that the unit of SI unit of electric charges coulomb, denoted by capital C. Coulomb is the name of a scientist. That's why in writing full, I'm starting the first letter by small c. Now, there are two kinds of properties of electric charge. First, opposite charges or unlike charges attract each other, and similar or like charges repel each other. Now, as we have studied that one proton contains 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19 coulomb charge in it. So by this we can find that in 1 coulomb of charge, how many number of electrons are present in it? In 1 coulomb of charge, how many number of electrons contains 1 coulomb charge? So, as we know that charge of one electron is equal to 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19 coulomb. Therefore, number of electrons in 1 coulomb is equal to 1 upon 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19 into 1. We can solve it by elementary method. Therefore, after solving we get that this value is equal to 10 raised to the power 19 by 1.6, and it is equal to 1 upon 1.6 can be written as 6.25 into 10 raised to the power 18 electrons. Thus, 1 coulomb of charge contains 6.25 into 10 raised to the power 18 electrons in it. Thus, we can conclude that 1 coulomb is a very big unit of electric charge. Now, what do you mean by conductors? Conductors are those substances through which electricity can flow easily. Or these are those substances in which there are free number of electrons present in an atom. For example, metals, all metals are conductors. Metals like silver, copper, aluminium, etc., all are good conductors. Also, we can talk about alloys in this. Alloys like nichrome. Alloys are mixture of metals. So nichrome, magnesium, and constantin or we can say conductors are carbon in the form of graphite or human body all are good conductors. Now, what do you mean by insulators? Those substances through which electricity cannot pass or flow easily. These are insulators. These are those substances through which electricity cannot flow easily and we can say that free electrons are not present. Because free electrons are responsible to conduct electricity. For example, drywood, paper, cotton, dry air, glass, ebonite rod, mica, all are insulators. Now we are able to answer this question that if why we consider some substances are conductors and some as insulators. So the answer is some substances are conductors. Because in those substances, some electrons are loosely bound. As we have discussed it earlier also, loosely bound by nuclei. Or if I am talking about one atom, so nucleus. So this electron can move from one atom to other and conducts electricity. But in case of insulators, electrons are tightly bound with nucleus. Now, other topic is, we have studied about electricity now. Electricity is a flow of charge in a conductor, but in general, electricity is of two types. Static electricity and current electricity. Static is that in which all the charges present in a substance is in rest. And in current electricity, charges present in substances are in motion. So in our syllabus, we are studying this charging in motion. That is, if charges are in motion, for example, all electrical equipments which we see in our homes, offices, and in transport we use for to run an electric motor, etc. For example, all electric equipment. Charges in rest, example is lightning. Which we see in sky, and when we rub two objects together, that is by friction, charge produced by friction. This is static electricity and current electricity. Now, other topic is, how current flow in a circuit? Now see, let us suppose this is a battery. Battery is the combination of cells. And what is the meaning of cell? Cell is one positive electrode and other is negative electrode. That is, one is at higher potential and other is at lower potential. We will study further about what do you mean by potential. So, right now, just study that cell, battery is a group of cells. This is a battery through which I have connected a key, that is on off plug. One ammeter. Ammeter is an instrument which is used to measure the magnitude of current. How much current is flowing through this wire? This is known as ammeter. Another is a conductor or a load like bulb or any other electrical equipment. Across it, I have connected a voltmeter that is parallel, and other is a rheostat to change the value of resistance. Now, as I switch on the key, then what happens? The current starts flowing from positive terminal end. This is also a positive end. This is negative end. Here it is positive, it is negative. And it will flow in this manner through the and will complete the whole circuit. And this is the direction of current. this is a conducting wire, that is metal, made up of metal like copper or aluminium. Conducting wire. Now, this is the direction of current denoted by I, and in opposite direction at the same time electrons will start moving from negative electrode to positive electrode. So this is the flow or the direction of flow of electrons. So this is the way how current flows in a circuit from positive electrode of a cell to the negative electrode of cell. And now, what do you mean by electric current? Electric current is a flow of charge per unit time, or we can say rate of flow of charge. Given by capital I, and I is equal to the charge flowing per unit time. By this we can write its unit also. Its unit is charge is given in coulomb and time in second. So we can write coulomb per second, or as it was derived or it was discovered by scientist Ampere. So after his name, I can write unit ampere or capital A. Current also measure in milliampere or microampere. So 1 milliampere is equivalent to milli means 10 raised to the power minus 3 ampere, and micro is 10 raised to the power minus 6 ampere. These are the available ranges in which instrument is there to measure the magnitude of current. Now the next term is, what do you mean by electric potential? Electric potential is given by capital V, and it is that potential which is at a point, and it is defined as the work done in moving a unit positive charge from one point to other point, or we can say from infinity to this point. Let us suppose we need to calculate the value of electric potential at this point. This is a circuit, and this is a load like bulb, and at this point I need to calculate the value of electric potential. So the work done which I will do by this battery, the work done in bringing a unit positive charge, the value of charge, is known as work done per unit charge in bringing this charge from one point to other point, or we can say from infinity to a point. This is a required point. So the work done per unit charge is known as electric potential. So what is the definition? Write it. It is defined as the work done in moving a unit positive charge from infinity to that point where we need to calculate electric potential. And its SI unit is volt. And it is given by work done per unit charge. Its unit is volt, or we can write joule per coulomb. Capital J, capital C. Now, what do you mean by potential difference? We have studied about electric potential. It is the work done in moving or in bringing a unit positive charge from infinity to a required point is known as electric potential. And potential difference is also denoted by capital V, and it is defined as the amount of work done in moving a unit positive charge from one point to other point. That point can be considered as infinity also. And it is given by potential difference equal to work done upon quantity of charge moved. And it can also be written as work done per unit charge. So here, what is the difference between electric potential and potential difference? Electric potential is the potential at a point, one point. And here we are bringing a unit in the electric potential. We are bringing a unit positive charge from any point which is not even known to us, and its value, electric potential value, is not known to us. And if it is given to us also, then here we are not comparing the potential of these two. Here, in electric potential, we are not comparing the potential here, only we are finding the potential at one point. So work done in bringing a positive charge from infinity or from one point to other point. So finding the potential at one point is called electric potential. And on comparing these two potential, if one these are the two points, it has some potential and it has also at some potential. So on comparing or taking the difference of these two potential gives us the potential difference. Now, potential difference is given by work per unit charge. And by this we can define 1 volt. 1 volt is equal to that amount of work done, or 1 joule of work done in bringing 1 coulomb of charge to that point. Or by this we can write its unit, that is joule per coulomb. 1 volt is equal to joule per coulomb. 1 joule per coulomb. Potential difference is measured by an instrument known as voltmeter. Now, what do you mean by voltmeter? It's an instrument by which we can measure the amount of potential difference. and voltmeter is always connected in parallel. The important thing which you have to keep in mind is voltmeter is an instrument used to measure potential difference, and it is always connected in parallel to the load. Why? Because this voltmeter has very high resistance. We make that kind of voltmeter which has very high resistance, so that if resistance is more, that is obstruction offered in circuit is more, then the electrons will not able to flow. The flow of electrons will be negligible from this voltmeter, and thus there will be no current pass through it. So our motive is to find, this is the resistance of this voltmeter, and it is very high. And if we want to calculate the current, we connect ammeter in series. So high resistance is there. First of all, we are talking about voltmeter. Voltmeter is also denoted by V symbol. And here it has high resistance, so that it will not draw, or it will draw a negligible current from the circuit. And its work is used, its work is to measure the potential difference across the conductor. Now, what is the use of ammeter? Ammeter is denoted by capital A, and it has very low resistance. It is used to measure magnitude of current. We know that current is a scalar quantity, that is, it has no direction. If it has low resistance, thus it will draw maximum current from it and measure the value of current. Now, another important term is, what do you mean by EMF of a cell? First of all, cell is a combination of two electrodes. Positive, that is at higher potential. At lower potential, that is, the work done per unit charge is very less. The work done per unit charge is more. This is also known as positive electrode, negative electrode. Now, EMF of a cell is when no current is drawn from a cell, that is, switch is on, that is, the cell is in open circuit. Then we say that the potential difference between the cell or between the ends of a cell, terminals also we can say, is called electromotive force or EMF, and its unit is, or SI unit is also volt. So what do you mean by EMF? When the cell is not on or the cell is in open circuit, then that potential difference across the cell is known as electromotive force. And its opposite is known as terminal voltage of a cell. So what do you mean by terminal voltage? When the cell is on, the potential difference across the cell is called terminal voltage. That is, when current is drawn, from a cell, that is, the switch is on or the cell is closed. Your cell is in closed circuit. Then the potential difference between electrodes of cell is called terminal voltage. So here, when the cell is open, no current will be drawn. Thus, we will not show it by arrow. This is the symbol of current, or this is the indication of a current. So here, we will not show the direction of current, and when the switch is off, then the direction of current is from positive to negative. The EMF of a cell or a fresh cell, one cell is known as primary cell. The EMF of primary cell, that is, one is known as Daniell cell. Its EMF, that is, when the current is not drawn from the cell, it is equal to 1.08 volt. And another primary cell is, the cells, primary cells are those cells which are not chargeable. Daniell cell, and another is Leclanche cell. Its EMF is 1.5 volt. That is, it's not terminal voltage. It's a EMF of a cell, which is that EMF when the cell is not in use or when the switch is not on. So now, other topic is, and a very important topic, that is Ohm's law. Ohm's law states that at constant temperature or at constant physical conditions, the current flowing through a circuit or a conductor is directly proportional to the potential difference across the ends of a conductor. That is, I is proportional to V, or we can write V is proportional to I. It means that if V is 2, it doesn't mean that I is also 2 in magnitude. It means that if voltage is increasing by 2, whatever the number it has, in that amount, the current will also get increased. So let us suppose the initial value of voltage of a battery is, or of any conductor is, let us suppose 6 volt, and the current flowing through it is 2 ampere. Now, as we know that V is proportional to I, it means that if I'll increase voltage by some number, say 3 volt, so the current will also increase by 3. That is, now the voltage will become 18 volt. And the current at that time will be 6 ampere. So, as Ohm's law is given by V is proportional to I, or I is proportional to V. This is Ohm's law. And further, it is given by V is equal to R into I, where R is a proportionality constant called resistance of a conductor. Or we can say this resistance is given by the ratio of the potential difference across the conductor by the current flowing through that conductor. R is a constant. Now, here, so what we have learned? We have learned that V is equal to IR is not Ohm's law. This is a relation between V, I and R simply. So what is Ohm's law? Ohm's law is that is at constant temperature, the current flowing through a conductor is directly proportional to the potential difference across the ends of that conductor. This is Ohm's law. So what is the unit of resistance from this? That is volt per ampere, we can write. Or the unit of resistance is ohms, as it was given by scientist ohms. We can write ohm, or this is the symbol known as omega. Now, what do you mean by this resistance? Resistance is the obstruction or obstacle offered by a substance in the flow of current. More is the obstruction, less will be the current flow. Now, this resistance R depends on first, nature of the conductor or a substance, length of a conductor or a substance, area of cross section, and the last one is temperature of a conductor or a substance. So, see one by one. First is nature. Good conductors, if we consider good conductors like silver and copper, So these conductors offer less resistance. And bad conductors like wood, paper, etc. offers more resistance, thus less electricity flow. Now second is length. So longer wire has more resistance. And shorter wire has less resistance. Third one is area. In case of resistance, thick wire will have less resistance. And thin wire has more resistance. The last one is temperature. If we talk about good conductor, that is metals. In case of metals, when we increase or when we raise the temperature, resistance of metal also increases. And on lowering the temperature, resistance will get decrease. Now here in temperature, when we talk about an insulator, so there is no effect on insulator of temperature. Does not depend. And semiconductors, which are having the properties between conductors and insulators. In semiconductors, when we raise the temperature, there is a decrease in resistance. Now, what are the units of resistance? We have discussed it. Units of resistance are, number one is ohm. And higher units are kilo ohm. This is an SI unit which is internationally accepted. Kilo ohm is also another unit of resistance denoted by small k ohm, and other unit is mega ohm, that is capital M small omega or capital M omega, no difference. There is no small or bigger symbol of omega. Now we have studied that R is the ratio of V by I By this, we can conclude that first is I is proportional to V. That is, if V is doubled, then I also gets doubled. And the second point is, I is proportional to 1 by R. What does it mean? That is, if R is doubled, I gets halved. Now students, one important thing is, its circuit. When we will connect it practically, all the equipments or instruments, then it obeys Ohm's law. How? See that. First of all, we will connect a battery. Battery will provide us more potential difference. Thus, in place of cell, we use battery. This is a symbol of a key, battery. Now, in series, we will connect an ammeter used to measure magnitude of current. Positive end is connected to positive end, then it is said to be connected in series. Now we will connect this with the load, and load is connected with voltmeter in parallel. This is the parallel way to connect the instrument, and we will, after that, we will connect a rheostat which is used to vary the value of resistance in the circuit. This is rheostat, and this is a sliding contact. We can slide it over it. Sliding contact. And further we'll connect it. This is the circuit diagram for verification of Ohm's law. Here, when we will switch on the key, then the current will start flowing from this end, and how much current is flowing can be measured with the help of ammeter, and then we will connect a voltmeter across this load, and this voltmeter is used to measure the potential difference across this load, and by this rheostat, and this rheostat, one end of this rheostat is connected to the key. Now, what is the graph between V and I? Graph is drawn between two axes, and if we will draw the graph between V and I, we have to keep in mind two things. One is, if we are taking x-axis and y-axis for plotting the graph, then here, if we will take on x-axis, if we will take current, and on y-axis, if we will take V, then as we know that when V increases, I increases. At each and every point, if I increases, V increases. So, we get the points in this way. That is this. The value of R will be same at every point. V by I, V by I, V by I, and V by I. And when we'll join them, we get a straight line known as R. Now, one thing remember that R or this straight line is known as slope of this graph. And slope is given by y-axis or change in y-axis by change in x-axis. Now here, what is the change in y? The change in y shows the change in v, and change in I shows the change in I. X-axis shows the change in I. That's why we can write del v by del r, that is y by x. And this gives the ratio of del v by del I gives us a constant known as r. But what students do, they plot a graph in this manner. Let us suppose this is our studied graph, V, graph between V and I. This is given as R. But what students do, they take I here and V here and plot a straight line graph and say this is R. So it is not R, because R is a slope, del y by del x, and del y here is now change in I, and there it is a change in V. So this slope is now become 1 by R. So remember this, del I by del V is 1 by R, not R. Now, next term is, what do you mean by conductance? Conductance is reciprocal of resistance. Denoted by symbol sigma. And its SI unit is, more is the resistance, thus we can say more is the resistance, less will be the conductance. SI unit of sigma is 1 by ohm, or it can be written as ohm inverse, or we can write it as moho, or in this form also ohm inverse. Or symbol of moho is this, or its other unit is Simon. Now, what do you mean by resistivity? Resistivity is denoted by symbol rho. And it is the characteristic property of a substance. It's not resistance, but it is used to compare resistance of two or more resistances. Used to compare resistance of two or more resistances or more substances. This resistivity formula is, we can derive its formula, as we know that We have studied that resistance is directly proportional to the length of a conductor, and also resistance is proportional to 1 upon area of cross section. So this is let equation 1, equation 2. On combining both the equation, we get R proportional to L by A. Or when we will remove this proportionality sign, we will get R is equal to rho L by A. Here, rho can be written as R A by L. So, this is the formula of resistivity. By this, we can see that resistivity is proportional to resistance, as area and length will be same for one substance. So, we can say that more will be the resistivity, more is the resistance. Less is the resistivity, less will be the resistance. Now, by this formula, we can derive the SI unit of rho. It is given as we know, resistance unit is ohm, and unit of area is meter square. Unit of length is meter, so meter and meter will cancel out, and we are remain with rho is equals to ohm meter. So this is the SI unit of resistivity. Now one important thing is resistivity depends on nature of a substance and temperature of a substance. And rho does not depend on length and thickness of a substance. Now, we can discuss this nature also here. Now, we can see that good conductors have low resistivity. This is similar to resistance. Good conductors have low resistivity. And bad conductors have high resistivity. And one another substance, that is alloys. Alloys have very high resistivity as compared to pure metals. Because of this, we use metals like copper and aluminium to make transmission wires, that is for transmission of electricity. And we use alloys like magnesium is an alloy of copper, manganese and nickel. And constantin is an alloy of copper and nickel. these alloys are used to make resistance wires. Thus, we can see that as metals conduct electricity, so they are used to make wires. And here alloys have very high resistivity, therefore they are used to make resistance wires. And another alloy is known as, name is nichrome. It has very high resistivity. Thus, this nichrome is used to make heating element wire. Nichrome, because it has high resistivity. And the second one is, it does not undergo oxidation, that is, will not burn even at high temperature. This is all about resistivity. Now we can compare resistance and resistivity by a whole studies which we have done till now. That is, resistance is a physical property. Rho is also a physical property. Now, resistance offers obstruction in flow of electrons. In resistivity, it is a characteristic property of a material. Other one is second difference is, it is denoted by R, it is denoted by rho. Third one, in the formula we can see that resistance is given by V by I equal to R, or R can be written as rho L by A. Here rho can be written as RA by L. Other difference is, fourth difference between R and rho is, R depends on L and R depends on 1 by A, but rho depends on nature and rho depends on temperature. And the last difference is, SI unit of R is ohm and its SI unit is ohm meter. So this is all about resistance and resistivity. In our next class, we will study about the combinations of resistances.